Hi there, I'm Mark Dwyer, and I'm here to talk to you today about amazing fragrant plants and making them accessible. Starting out with a beautiful image of fragrant stocks or matthiola here, amazing perfumey scent out in the garden. And the intent with the discussion today is simply to talk about a wide range of fragrant plants that can be enjoyed out in the garden. But the challenge, however, with many user groups is making sure those plants are accessible. I come with a background currently working at the Edgerton, Wisconsin Hospital and Health Services Healing Garden, and this 3-acre space has a whole lot of fragrant plants, very heavy on sensory engagement, an all accessible space that's open to the public. And this year, we included over 100 varieties of fragrant plants. And lending itself to the topic at hand, the importance of providing accessibility and identification and letting people know that engagement was encouraged. I also designed a wellness garden at Rotary Botanical Garden in Gainesville, Wisconsin, where I was employed for 21 years. And you'll note in this image some raised beds and lots of color. The intention with this space was also sensory engagement, including a wide range of fragrant plants, which I think is one of the most exciting components we can include in the garden, which can certainly be beautiful with color and textures, but that fragrance adds so much more to a space. And there's another image of that garden itself. Well, fragrance in the garden, the idea of calming scents, the idea, again, stress and depression can be alleviated with fragrances. There's my grandson Miles on the left. I'll show him a couple of times shamelessly smelling a crab apple in spring. But it's important to mention, you know, there's a lot of research done with scent and its benefits in terms of memory enhancement, relaxation, various aromatherapy approaches. But scent is provided by plants in two ways, really. Emission, the idea that scent is perfuming the air, it's emitted, or tactile engagement, that we're touching, rubbing, and then smelling. The timing of the scent becomes important, not just the time of year, when is that plant available to be offering scent, but maybe that scent is provided in later afternoon or is more prevalent in the evening hours. That becomes important as it applies to your user groups. When are you going to be out in the garden? Proximity for engagement is simply how close are these plants to the users? Are they nearby where they can engage? If they're emitting a fragrance, can that be captured? Can it be utilized? So again, that proximity to fragrant plants is extremely vital if you want people to enjoy them. How close do we need to have those plants to our user group? And I love this image. This is a young lady who, this is Dill, and this is not a stage shot, but it was interesting when this image was being taken, the question was being asked, what do you smell? And she said, pickle plant. So she associated this with pickles, which evidently she didn't care for. But again, there's an expression, and certainly fragrance is bringing out some sort of a reaction, which is important. And keep in mind, scent is subjective. Not everyone appreciates all the different fragrances, but it's a component that I think we do notice out in the landscape with, you know, what's that smell? And there's so much we can do with an amazing array of plants. So as I mentioned, it is subjective. Not everyone loves the scent of lilacs. I mean, I do. There's a beautiful lilac on the right, but the intensity of scent, I alluded to this earlier, can differ as the day progresses. There's humidity components, the temperature. So there's a lot of factors at play, of course, but I also feel that scent is overdramatized in plant descriptions. I've created entire fragrant gardens and using plants that were new to me and felt that they had very minimal scent. So we'll focus today on some of those that I think are the most impactful or potent in terms of fragrance. And there's Miles with lilacs and my wife, Grandma. We go to a local arboretum every spring, and he's a huge fan of lilacs already. And there's my younger daughter, who's now 23, smelling snowdrops in late March in our climate in southern Wisconsin. And a very, very subtle fragrance. Again, fragrance doesn't always hit you over the head, but it can be something subtle that just adds that additional component. As does the beauty of snowdrops so early in late winter, early spring. Flowering tobacco, just an example, is a woodland tobacco that emits its primary sweet fragrance in the evenings. And what's amazing about that fragrance is it really goes over a wide radius. And this plant is an annual and ultimately provides a wealth of fragrance through the summer months. Back to the healing garden in Edgerton, noticed some flowering tobacco behind this bench. And that was, we talk about proximity issues. The intention here is this little bench, which doesn't compromise the path width of 8 feet. So people can still traverse the path rather. Ultimately sitting in this bench, imagine at dusk, enjoying the cloying scent of those flowering tobaccos. And then an example of a tactile engagement. I think one of the best lemon scented plants is lemon verbena. Here, very clear lemon scent. And lemon verbena has a lot of culinary uses and historic uses, and the importance of providing it, it's hard to see in this image, but this is in a raised bed where folks in a wheelchair or those that can't stoop or get down to ground level can enjoy it. And that's something to consider is, again, we'll get into more discussion a little bit later here with accessibility, but those aromatic plants have to be positioned in such a way where they're accessible to the widest range of users or specifically to the user group in which you're working. There's Miles again with some sunflowers, which have very little to no scent, but you know, kids have to smell those flowers, and what a great image. But there's so much research out there, quantitative, and that ultimately shows studies where scent, again, evokes memories. It can help improve memory. It can relay with when there's some memory loss issues, the idea of, again, hearkening back to another time. And it's been illuminating to read some of these. So they are out there. But again, with fragrance, we do have to address the seasonality. Depending on the climate in which you live, when can you have your earliest scent out in the garden and your latest? And for me, that's really early April until October-ish in the Midwest here. But bringing the garden inside is another idea. And at the Healing Garden, which I work, something we do is a lot of fresh cut arrangements of fragrant plants brought in to some of the user groups that might be able to view the garden from within the hospital that can't get outside. So the idea that we can bring fragrant plants into a setting, not just bring people into a setting that provides those. But you have to let people know that these plants are fragrant. It's one thing to smell a plant that's emitting fragrance, but to say, hey, rub this and smell, particularly those tactilely engaged plants, becomes important. I love this quote by Beverly Nichols, to be overcome by the fragrance of flowers is a delectable form of defeat. And I totally agree with that. There's Miles again smelling a Gavota tulip, very light fragrance. There are fragrant tulips. This one is not so much, but he again is at a young age already interested in smelling those plants. And here are some new signs we added at the Healing Garden, which is encouraging people to come to this plant. And that very lace leaf plant just beneath the sign you see there is a scented geranium or pelargonium, and it's a pine scented geranium. And I kid you not, when you rub and smell this, it's like a pine forest. And what a great component. And we had over 50 varieties of scented geraniums. Some of them exaggerated in terms of fragrance, but some really interesting ones. And I'll show those as we go a little bit further into this. A sign at the New York Botanic Garden in a sensory garden talking about the different senses. Notice taste is not included. And in a public setting, there's a reason for that. And it's allergies, liability concerns. They may be growing vegetables and herbs, but they're not promoting active consumption by visitors. So yes, the fifth sense is omitted from the signage, but these are the types of things that we should be encouraging in landscapes and gardens. Our home gardens, our healthcare gardens, and ultimately, again, that fragrance becomes so vital in my mind. And here's a great example of bringing that garden in. This is an arrangement I cut just a couple weeks ago with some odds and ends, but the most colorful flowers you see in there are those fragrant stalks. That first image I showed was one of those beautiful, very perfumey scented here in the main lobby where people can catch a scent and or lean in a little bit and smell it. And we would replace this every week minimally. And, you know, settings that provide fragrant plants or sensory plants. And if you are in the Chicago area, do visit the Chicago Botanic Garden. The Bueller Enabling Garden has been around for a while, and beautiful raised beds, nice setting, all accessible, water features. There's a lot of neat things happening in this small space, and that includes fragrance as well. But I just want to show you an example of a space, and we'll circle back to some of the features of raised beds. And again, the secondary component of our discussion, and that's not just fragrant plants, but how to elevate and shift them into a position where they can be enjoyed by our users. And there's that Bueller Enabling Garden. I'm only about 2 hours from Chicago Botanic Garden, so I visit as often as I can. And here's a spring shot with lots of wonderful color. Interesting raised beds here set up these trays are at three different heights, and that's for three different wheelchair heights where the user can actually slide under and get quite close to the plant material. Limited soil volume, so that dictates what you can grow in terms of plant material. But if you look a little further, the yellow and the pink are wallflower and nemesia, respectively, both of which are actually fragrant. This is a mid-spring shot. But notice some of the cool season vegetables and other fun things happening in a May shot at the Bueller Enabling Garden. In a summer shot I took very recently, different angle, but again, notice the accessibility here. Bringing these plants, whether they're fragrant or not, they can be enjoyed by those in wheelchairs or certainly waist height. Again, the idea of getting down to ground level to even garden, let alone smell something, can become more problematic as we get older, or we may have challenges in which that becomes a little more difficult. When I was at Rotary Botanical Gardens in Janesville, we created a smelly garden for 2 years, and we love the name of it, but one of the fun things we did was included a wide range of sort of scratch and sniff, rub me sort of plants with labels. And there's a lot of mints and scented geraniums and some exciting stuff in here. And notice this double seating wall was utilized by these containers so people could walk along and engage in these various scents. And that included a wide range of herbs, but it was really an interesting exploration for our visitors to find the scent of rose and lemon, strawberry, apricot. It goes on and on. Chocolate, vanilla. You'll see some plants very shortly that smell like popcorn. So, you know, again, scent is subjective, but there's nothing wrong with doing a little more focus on those plants that'll offer something. We'll again circle back to the idea of elevating our plants, and specifically our fragrant plants, but I use the term belly button height planter in this case because, again, in a no-stoop gardening situation, and the Healing Garden in Edgerton is a great example, for some of our user groups and our active therapy endeavors, the intent is gardening or engagement at waist height, standing and reaching into these spaces, not crawling around, or particularly when there's a mobility issue. Again, a garden like this has its own nuances of soil preparation, drainage, plant care. There's a lot of things involved here, but the idea of bringing the garden up makes a lot of sense in so many of our situations in horticultural therapy. Knowing your plant becomes absolutely important, and as it relates to scented as well, because we have here on the right, there's valerian, which is sweet smelling. It smells a lot like vanilla, extremely sweet smelling. Valerian has thousands of years of medicinal history. It's an amazing herb for many reasons. It's also a prolific reseeder. It's a nightmare in terms of reseeding, so you have to be wary of that, of course. But woody plants, perennials, and seasonal plants may contribute scent. And the reason I mention that is when we talk about a progression of scent, we might have that lilac in spring, but then we start relying on some summer blooming perennials, some seasonal plants. That window of fragrance should involve all different types of plants that are both emitters and tactilely engaged. So that seasonal timing I've mentioned twice already becomes important. Valerian here is an early summer fragrance, this blooming for about 4 to 5 weeks. But again, be wary. And knowing your plant, I'd be wary of planting valerian, to be honest. So you need to be careful. But that placement to maximize engagement and accessibility becomes important. And that of course, is the crux of the discussion, making sure that folks can get to these fragrances and enjoy them as part of a program or simply relaxation and immersion in an open garden space, being outside. Knowing your plant is additionally important when we talk about something like heliotrope on the left, which is extremely fragrant. I digress a little bit by saying the white heliotrope smells like pure vanilla, and the blue is quite fragrant, although there are some blue varieties that are not fragrant. So know your heliotrope, but also know that it's poisonous. So this is poisonous to you and your dog and your horses. And if there's ever a concern of ingestion, meaning the user group might grab and put something in their mouth, or in an unsupervised situation where consumption might be a consideration, knowing your toxic plants in any garden setting makes sense. I'm preaching to the choir. I understand that. But heliotrope is included in many fragrant gardens, but it is extremely poisonous. So you need to just know that. And there's other poisonous plants we use in our garden as well, but in particularly a healthcare setting where concern for our patients and liability comes into play, poisonous plants need to be understood. But knowing your plant also refers to knowing what it likes for soil, watering regime, sunlight. That's important because you can't just, you know, plunk these plants in and hope for the best. You need to know a little bit about what they need. And so diving into some of the woody plants, here's an extremely durable woody shrub. This is actually a shrub rose, Blanc Double de Corbeil. What's wonderful about this plant is two flushes of bloom. So on the left there, you see it in later spring, early summer, extremely fragrant, very durable, hardy shrub rose. It's very few insect or disease problems as well, but right now it's going through a secondary flush of flowering in very late summer into early fall. And so, you know, roses people tend to be wary of for the care, but a shrub rose like this can be dynamic. Now, covered with thorns, so that's something to keep in mind, but ultimately providing scent for many, many weeks over again in late spring and then now. I love Korean spice viburnums, and of course, this is a very Midwestern-centric talk. And so for those of you in other areas, you need to extrapolate some of the ideas for including it, the emission of scent, this being a close-up of a flower cluster in spring, where Korean spice viburnum emits an unbelievably sweet fragrance over a wide radius. And again, only blooming for about 3 weeks in spring, but a shrub that's durable, also has great fall color, but might be something, a component in a garden setting where heavy spring fragrance is provided by woody plants, which is not unusual. You've seen lilacs a couple times already. The witch alders or Father Gila, another great plant for showing amazing scent there with bottle brush blooms in spring. Mock orange, very common. I show EA bowls here because it's variegated, has a white margin on the leaves. So mock orange in bloom is unbelievably fragrant, but mock orange out of bloom is not overly exciting in terms of, you know, it's kind of a green blob. So having this variegation makes this variety look great from leaf emergence all the way till fall. But you have the benefit again of the spring, late spring flowers. In a close-up of fragrant abelia, just amazing fragrance on an arcing plant. Here it is in spring. This is actually what I feel to be the sweetest spring fragrance personally. Now it's kind of an unkempt arcing shrub. This isn't something you do a lot of pruning on. And again, maintenance and care go hand in hand with all our gardens, but this also has the benefit of great fall color, which is a story for another time, but we're getting another season of interest out of it. In summer, these summer sweets or clethras, still talking about woody shrubs here, there's a lot of white and pink forms like ruby spice that offer a nice fragrance in the summer months. And you don't find a lot of woody plants that offer fragrance in summer. So this is one. They're a little tricky because they like moist, acidic soil. So you need to, again, know how to keep these plants happy. Great for pollinators as well. A white fringe tree, here's an understory tree, can take a lot of shade. Here it is in spring, very wispy, fragrant blooms. Both the male and female of this species bloom beautifully like this. The females form some interesting fruits later on, but a haze of white offering just a wonderfully sweet fragrance. A very, very durable understory tree. And I'm giving you just a sampling of some of the woody plants. Wisteria, you know, wisteria can actually be a bit of a thuggish vine, but there are some native North American species that are less problematic. I'd be wary of Chinese and Japanese wisterias because they really can encompass a structure. But wisteria in bloom, like prolific here, extremely fragrant. And so vining woody plant, if there's a structure or a situation where vines have benefit, consider the fragrance provided by these mid-spring bloomers. And I show this in passing, Cercidophyllum, the Latin's a mouthful, but this is Katsura tree, which is not native. This is native to Asia. Here it is with its fall color, which is coming up very shortly. And This is at Rotary Botanical Gardens, and I'll make the story brief here, but there was a day in fall, in October, where it smelled like cotton candy, literally, and I just couldn't figure out what it was. And I found out later that Katsura tree, at a point when the leaves have turned yellow, their fall color, which is quite nice, and are just getting ready to drop, emits a fragrance like cotton candy over a wide radius, and it's unbelievable. So would you include a Katsura tree in a healthcare situation or a healing garden? Well, it's a great tree in general. It can get quite large, but the fact that for about a week it offers this amazing fragrance is, I think, noteworthy. In spring, you know, garden hyacinths offering fragrance. Again, we're trying to run the gamut of early spring into fall in our climate. So something like including hyacinths in your landscape, you're going to address that in fall with fall planting of the dormant bulbs, and then getting this in late April, early May, at least in our climate. And here are some hyacinths inserted into a spring container. This container becoming something entirely different by midsummer, but here with tulips, grape hyacinths, and those fragrant creamy white garden hyacinths. And getting into perennial plants, something like phlox. This is a hybrid phlox. So fragrance and perennials, there are quite a few fragrant perennials, and this is a summer bloomer, mini pearl, great clear white flowers. This is one of my favorite phlox, by the way, but the closely related garden phlox that bloom in July into later summer are also quite fragrant, particularly at dusk. But again, knowing your plant proximity in terms of placement, but a segue of fragrance becomes important, and something like phlox can fill that summer void. As can dianthus. This is one of the pinks is the common name, and this is an extreme close-up of a fairly small blossom, maybe an inch and a half. So you see this fringed flower, and I've grown rainbow loveliness for, oh my gosh, 20 years, and it is a perennial to zone 5 if you're familiar with hardiness zones. But the fragrance it emits is unbelievable. Ideally positioned and elevated a little bit so people can get a little closer, but it is extremely fragrant. I would rank this as one of the top 10 more fragrant perennials that we can grow. And there's and beautiful to look at as well. Many of the pinks are fragrant, although some more than others. You can't go wrong with lilies. You have to be a little wary with understanding your lilies, because not all lilies are fragrant. So here's royal lily, which is extremely fragrant and blooms in midsummer and ultimately perfumes the air. And so lilies can fill a great void, and satisfaction you see here when we talk about a progression of bloom. This is what's called an orient pet lily. It's a hybrid lily between oriental lilies, which are fragrant, and a trumpet lily, which offers some height and a little more vigor. And what you're not seeing is this is blooming at about 4 to 5 feet. So I planted 50 of these in a garden where every summer for about 15 years now, they've come up, hovered, and just perfumed the air. So really quite amazing in terms of contribution. And lilies have their share of issues. You know, when we talk about knowing your plant, that includes not only maintenance, but potential insect and disease problems. So scouting out issues, because an investment in planting something like this, you want it to thrive for many years. So our permanent plantings, quote unquote, with woody plants and perennials, it's imperative to understand their needs. The annuals we use sort of as window dressing in our containers and open spots, but you'll find as we talk more about fragrance, there's a wide spectrum of seasonal plants we're heading into here that can offer some amazing opportunity to engage folks. And we'll start, I mentioned white heliotrope, again, poisonous, but I do want to mention, you know, pure vanilla is what you smell from this. So if it's a situation where that toxicity is not an issue, the proximity of this, allowing someone to get fairly close, leaning in, it's magical. Remember my earlier comment, however, that some of the blue forms are not fragrant. So do a little research into those that are. You're better off buying these as a plant, an established plant, because they're ready to bloom, and they'll bloom all summer for you. Very heat tolerant. Here's one of the many blue forms, this one being fragrant. And, you know, to our discussion at hand, it wasn't hard for me to lean down and smell these, but not all of our users can do that. So again, circling back again to our topic, making sure that something like this is in a position to be enjoyed becomes important. Huge fan of chocolate cosmos. Many of you know cosmos is a seasonal. This is native to Mexico, so not hardy for the majority of our listeners today, I'm sure. What's interesting about this chocolate cosmos, if you get real close to these flowers, if you really lean in there, dark chocolate is what you get out of it. And the root system is quite tuberous. You actually can dig and store these. If you're familiar with storing dahlias or cannas, it's very similar in how you do this. But love chocolate cosmos. And here it is dangling over the wall at the Edgerton Hospital Healing Garden. And this has one of the Sniff Me signs and its own chocolate cosmos sign. So people are encouraged to lean in there and exclaim, oh my gosh, it smells like dark chocolate. Another plant that smells like chocolate is chocolate daisy. And this is a close-up. The flowers on these are smaller than 2 inches in diameter, but extremely fragrant. And so I believe this is a, I don't want to misspeak, but it might be a native wildflower in California. For most of it's a seasonal plant, but blooms throughout the summer and offers some amazing fragrance. I mentioned popcorn earlier. So here's cassia, also called senna. Didium mobitria, and this is a legume, and if you know what legumes, they're nitrogen fixers, so you see they're in the pea family. You see some very interesting blue-green foliage here, but some beautiful yellow flowers. I do want to warn you that this is also a toxic plant, so ingestion of any parts of the plant are not a good thing. But in our Midwest climate, we could grow this plant from a very small specimen in spring up to 6, 7, 8 feet tall. Gets waves of blossoms, these beautiful golden blossoms, and if you rub the buds, the top buds there, kind of rub and sniff, it smells like buttered popcorn. So hence the common name popcorn cassia. And at Rotary Gardens, we would plant about 200 of these, and not just back of the border because of their height, but up close and in containers with signage to tell people, hey, rub these, beat these up a little bit, take a smell. And unbelievable. And I think we created many gardeners from the kids that would go home and say, hey, I smelled a plant that smelled like popcorn. So interesting plant. There it is in a garden setting. So real interesting foliage. So not hardy for the majority of us in tropical climates, certainly, but this is grown as an annual for the majority of us. And the challenges of overwintering, there are ways to try to overwinter some of these, but they're challenging, and we won't have time to cover that today, but it is possible. And this is an image from a local school garden. We donated the popcorn cassias to the school program, and not a stage shot. Well, I guess maybe it is because they asked the kids to all rub and smell, but this plant was positioned so these kids could enjoy that. And maybe we've created 5 gardeners with that. Who knows? Fragrant tuberose. Well, this starts out as a bulb. You'd want to start this very early. So polyanthes is the Latin name, Mexican single is the form here. But when these bloom, and again, they have to be started very early in spring to be able to bloom by mid to late summer. And they'll bloom on 3, 4, 5 foot tall stalks, but this emits a sweet fragrance. And so at Rotary Gardens, we would start hundreds of these in containers in April to be able to kind of put them around the garden. So in knowing that they weren't going to provide this scent until later summer, but boy, did they come through. And the pearl is just a double form of polyanthes. So again, fragrant tuberose, and that bulb actually can be dug up in fall and stored, like the cannas and dahlias I mentioned earlier in reference to the chocolate cosmos. So they're I think, well worth the space. As we get into more annuals, you remember the woodland tobacco, Nicotiana. Not all Nicotiana are fragrant. Perfume lime, of course, the name is indicative of some scent, but Nicotiana comes in a wide range of colors. The perfume series has purple and pink and white. I love the lime, but again, Nicotiana, those that are fragrant, it's primarily at dusk that they emit the fragrance. And that's interestingly enough, the fragrance isn't specifically for humans. We enjoy it. It's specifically for pollinators, moths and other nighttime critters that will appreciate the scent and be drawn in for pollination purposes. But again, flowering tobacco, beautiful plant. That woodland tobacco I showed earlier, some of those will reseed. You'll find babies. You need to know that as well, but it's one of my favorite annuals in general. Lobularia, this is sweet alyssum. Many of you know this old-fashioned cottage garden annual. Snow Princess is one of many, many varieties, coming in a range of colors, but a nice sweet fragrance, particularly when you get up close. But Sweet Alyssum will bloom through the entire season and even take some light light frost as well. Here it is lining a path. Now imagine this up on an elevated situation where people could lean in there and take a whiff. The Alusianskaya, that's a mouthful, but this is night phlox. And so what happens during the day, if you see that sort of closed fist of maroon there, during the day the flowers are closed. And what they do at dusk and in the evening is they unfurl, they open, and they emit this fragrance. These are very small flowers. And I have to say, from a distance, you don't even notice this plant. But I use it at home, and we're using it at the healing garden because our healing garden has patients and staff that come out in the evening hours. And this thing does its thing in the evening, which is emits an unbelievable fragrance. So ornamentally speaking, not overly exciting, but in terms of emission of scent, top notch. So look in your seed catalogs. Right before you see zinnias, you'll see Zalusianskaya. And here it is. I happen to catch them in bloom in a morning before they would close up or finish blooming. The telenium is called pineapples. And what's amazing is, and we encourage folks, we had a sign here, notice raised bed, this is 30 inches up, so people walking by or in a wheelchair could reach over. These teeny little spheres, we would encourage people to pick one and squeeze it and smell, and it smells literally like pineapples, like right on. So when I say scent is subjective, I totally believe that, but I think I don't know anyone that said, this doesn't smell like pineapples. It was always like, oh my gosh. So this blooming powerhouse just kept doing this all summer. This is certainly not hardy, but a real fun plant. Also kind of interesting to look at. But we had a lot of little flowers there for people to smell pineapple. You saw fragrant stocks earlier, the Matthiola, excellent plant. It's a cool season annual for us, really. We don't count on it overwintering at all. But what was interesting this year is it normally likes the cooler end of the season, meaning May and June, and then in the heat of summer, it really shuts down. In many cases, it's treated just as a cool season annual for prior to the heat of summer and then removed. But ours just kept going and going. And as I speak, many of our stocks have bloomed not only all summer, but have a second flush of bloom as we head into a little bit cooler late summer into fall. Having said that, what you're looking at is it's a very floral, perfumey scent. And fragrant stocks have hundreds and hundreds of years of history as a fragrant plant in containers and in settings where that emission of scent is vital. Here it is combined with some salvia. That's a salvia called Smoky Jazz. Right now the hummingbirds are going bonkers for the salvia, and our visitors and patients are enjoying the fragrant stocks, which again have now contributed over 4 months of solid fragrance. And for folks leaving the hospital out into the healing garden, they come through these moon arches, which are brand new. These will actually have fragrant climbing roses in the future. But what you're seeing in the foreground here, pardon me, after folks coming through the progression of the moon gates, there's a huge ring of raised beds that's just chock full of about 1,000 of these fragrant stocks. So it's very prevalent as people come out into the space. And I actually park a distance from the hospital, and I enter the hospital this way from left to right. So every morning I'm inundated with the fragrant stocks, which has been amazing. But what a nice transition to a space where fragrance is immediate. There's a lot of petunias with fragrance. Evening Sensation is actually a relatively new variety with a beautiful color, but primarily at night. And there's some old-fashioned petunias, and not a specific endorsement per se, but I do want to say Select Seeds, which sells seeds and plants, is one of my sources for a wide range of scented geraniums, but also they have a huge category of fragrant plants as seed or plants. Evening Sensation you can find in other seed catalogs as well, but some of the old-fashioned petunias offer some amazing scent. And we've talked about tactile engagement, and I've already alluded to scented geraniums. I feel many are exaggerated. You know, apricot scented geraniums is one where I don't smell any apricot. But Lady Plymouth, a beautiful close-up of a leaf with a nice little white edge, very strong smell of rose. It's not hard to find citrusy or lemony scented geraniums, and many are sold citronella or mosquito plant. The idea of excluding mosquitoes in our landscapes, which isn't really true, to be honest. But having said that, the pelargoniums that have amazing scent include, you know, there's strawberry, there's one called Old Spice that smells like Old Spice deodorant. And again, we had 40 or 50 varieties this year. But the peppermint one is spot on. A very felty pubescent leaf, but we are telling patients, reach over and rub this and smell, and it's like a chewing gum menthol sort of peppermint. Really just amazing. There's one called nutmeg with an interesting variegated leaf. Here's a close-up of those leaves. Notice again, they're positioned along the raised beds. Mount carbine. So this is an interesting tranthus closely related to coleus. And this has a smell of pure lemon candy. And when we talk about sensory engagement, this is also extremely felty, velvety leaves. So the idea of touching these, very tactile experience. And consider a project with something like this where you can make a cutting and easily grow that. That could be something for patients or a user group as a project to perpetuate this amazing plant. Ginger bush, Tritheinia. So in a warmer climate, I'm not even sure where this is native, but this smells in rubbing the leaves like a combination of, primarily ginger, to be honest. And so really amazing. And back to my earlier comment, having the signage and the encouragement for folks to in our setting, as they're walking around, to know that they can engage these plants and what they are. So that's why we have a lot of these fragrant plant smell me signs. Vicks Vapor Rub plant, another plectranthus. If you remember Vicks Vapor Rub, which still exists, that intense menthol-y smell, these little leaves have it. And here you notice I took this image on the right very recently where it's trailing over our retaining wall. Notice the sign as well. Fragrant plant, sniff me. So, of course, garden herbs like salvias. You know, this is Burgarten. Now, culinary use, absolutely, but also a tactile, very soft, velvety leaf. Actually, Hardy did his own five, but there's golden salvias. And, you know, herbs can be put into containers, raised beds, garden beds. Look at the trailing oregano there. Not a culinary form, but does have the fragrance. So herbs have a lot of value. The cafe at the hospital where I'm employed, we're growing fresh herbs and vegetables for them, and having that readily at hand is nice. And I'll show you some of those raised beds. In fact, actually, this is one of our rolling raised beds down by the cafe where the purple-leafed sage is right there for whether it's for use, but certainly beauty as well. So a wide range of herbs has value. Something like fennel has that sort of licorice-y smell to it, and fennel having a lot of uses with its foliage and its seeds here combined with some celosia. But I won't wax poetic on all the plants you're seeing here, but bronze fennel, as you see here, has a beautiful contribution in the garden and also sensory engagement. Can recede a little bit, so you need to be aware of that. But dill, remember the pickle plant image of the young girl. Now here's fern leaf, which is a compact form. Dill being, you know, fresh dill having a lot of use, as well as dill seed. So again, I don't want to turn this into an herbal talk, but dill is one of those plants many of us can associate that scent with, absolutely, as we can with basils. Here's a raised bed at the Chicago Botanic Garden with a wide range of sweet basils, Thai basils, cinnamon basils, all with different subtle, not only flavor profiles, culinary, in terms of culinary use, but also interesting fragrance when smelled. Basils left to bloom are great for pollinators, although I will say sweet basils, you always want to deadhead or remove the blossoms. You want to encourage more foliar growth. Lavender, lots of those smellscape studies done with lavender. In fact, it's one of the more popular plants that people can associate with, and as an herb has a lot of different uses. Can be challenging to grow. Needs great drainage, doesn't like wet winters. Munstead's a solid variety, but again, lavender has such a long history, and many of us can associate that scent because we're familiar with it in perfumes, soaps, etc. Also has a edible potential as well in a wide range of uses, but that's one to consider, as with many of the mints. That Rotary Gardens image with all the containers that we set out, I mentioned a wide range of mints. It was fun. We picked about 20 different mints, and that included, there was a chocolate mint, there was, of course, peppermint and spearmint, but we had banana mint, orange mint, and they all had little subtle smells to them, but collectively, mints can be extremely aggressive. Now, here you see spearmint in a raised bed where we're not letting it escape. And the chef is using some of the leaves here, and the pollinators are loving the flowers. But be wary of mint and mint family relatives due to their spreading nature. But mints, you think about a fresh mint leaf, and it's just that clean, fresh smell. And that scent of lemon, you saw lemon verbena earlier, I mentioned, is a clear lemon scent. That plectranthus you saw earlier, by the way, that Mount Carbine, unbelievable lemon candy smell. Lemongrass, one of the most commonly used herbs around the world. Not overly ornamental, but just grabbing, pinching, and rubbing one of those leaves. Extreme lemon scent. A lot of culinary use, but imagine positioning it as we did here along a bed where we're telling people, go ahead and pick a leaf. Not hardy for us at all. We knew this was going to die with hard frost, so the intent was to beat it up a little bit and share it. We actually ended up cutting it for the cafe, who used primarily not so much the outer leaves as the closer to the crown, the thicker stems is what they were using in some of their stir fries and such. Accessibility, we'll go through this fairly quick because I don't want to turn this into a container talk, but when we talk about everything we've just looked at, all the fragrant plants, how do we bring them up or bring them to our visitors? And that's specific, of course, to the user group. Our healing garden has a diverse user group. So it's patients in beds, there's wheelchairs, there's therapy patients. And so we have a wide range of accessibility challenges to deal with, not just movement through the garden, but making sure our sensory plants can be engaged. And we've done that with a lot of the raised beds and some containers. But when you see a situation like this, this young lady managed a larger garden in her home situation. This is a independent living situation where she only has this patio. So years ago, when I was at Rotary Gardens, we built her this raised bed because she can't kneel and get back up. And as I get older, that becomes more of a challenge. And you think about traditionally gardening as we age. This is applicable where a raised bed like this, where you consider some of the accessibility issues, it's a matter of how do we engage those plants, but also how do we properly prepare those containers? How do we prepare those spaces that we're growing plants? The raised beds you see in this image, perfect height for wheelchair enjoyment. And this young lady in the wheelchair, that's her daughter pushing her through the wellness garden at Rotary Gardens, had amazing interaction with a wide range of sensory and tactile plants at wheelchair height. So again, bringing those plants to the user becomes important, but the behind the scenes is equally important. And I've hit that a couple times. It's how do we make sure these plants are doing well? And if they're permanent plants, those woody plants and perennials, how are we making sure we perpetuate those? So some examples, some raised beds for a volunteer group at Rotary Gardens where we crafted and devised various situations to bring vegetables up. So when we talk about raised beds, here's a municipal setting where a simple bench and a raised bed with some grasses. Incidentally, if you're from the Midwest, you might recognize that grass. That's prairie drop seed. And as it blooms in late summer into now, it actually has a very neat scent. It's very like a fresh, clean sort of fragrance to it. But in this case, a raised bed for beauty, for separating the sidewalk from the street. So a functional use of a raised bed. But imagine as a user or a gardener or somebody walking by, the plants have been brought up. They're there for you to get a closer look. So some dimensions to consider. The raised beds that I've devised in the two gardens I've worked at, we make sure that their width is only about 48 inches, 4 feet, because they're being worked from both sides, assuming a 2 foot reach for the average human. The idea that if you were to make a 6 foot wide bed, you'd struggle to reach to the middle. And I hope that makes sense. There's no reason to make overly wide beds. You want to be able to maintain reach and access the width of any bed, regardless of its length. So there's some different dimensions here for that belly button height for wheelchairs, and there's variable height of wheelchairs. And you saw the example at Chicago Botanic Garden about sliding under for accessibility in those tray planters. So there's also some dimensions for working from the side. soil depth becomes imperative. And remember the tray system at Chicago Botanic, those were 6-inch trays. So they weren't putting tomatoes in there. They were putting, you know, some greens and some annuals, but watering became an issue, I'm sure. So again, soil volume will dictate your, certainly dictate your plant palette to a certain degree. Understand that. Here's the cafe patio I alluded to earlier. This is a shot this year. That's a rolling planter, 6 foot long, 2 foot deep. If you look way in the distance, you see some stock tank planters we're also utilizing for vegetables. Not really accessible for patients in the distance, but these right here can actually be accessed very easily by just about anybody. And we're growing chard and basil and parsley and hot peppers, and that maroon plant is actually a sweet potato. Some fun things. Again, knowing what you're getting into, but there's a wide range of things we can do. There's an example where this isn't quite a good pairing of raised bed with the user. So Victoria, who's gardening there from the wheelchair, is really having to reach into that space. So a challenge for her, waist height for Janice and the brown, not a bad situation. But again, if these were aromatic plants we're trying to insert into the space and enjoy, whether it's for a program or simply, again, the sensory component, we want to make sure proximity of user is considered. And sometimes that's rustic here at assisted care in our county. You know, you can get a gardening fix from even a small space like this. And a campus that has no gardening space with the exception of this. So this is it, but at least from the paved side, there can be some access from wheelchairs and for those that can do some light stooping to get into this space. At Wellness Garden at Rotary Gardens, we devised, you know, it's a little fancier setup here, but two different bed heights for wheelchair accessibility and waist-high gardening, wide paths, no glare concrete, tinted concrete, and again, a real approach for getting people to those spaces. But again, this is what it amounts to. Being able to have our users enjoy the garden, whether it's an active participation like planting this or ultimately enjoying fragrant plants that might be trailing over the edge, becomes vital. Van Dusen Park in Iowa, notice the curved beds, wheelchair height, nice soft corners. Well, the assumption is this proper soil preparation, drainage, some trailing tomatoes here, but again, showing you some crafty examples here. This is the Betty Ford Alpine Garden, Vail, Colorado. Notice the rock work here. There's little irrigation heads in here, so these aren't drying out. But in this case, everyone can enjoy the contents of these raised beds. And at Edgerton, I'll be a little critical. This is early on, but notice access to this 4 foot wide bed is challenging on the left side. Another raised bed, also at Edgerton Hospital. Notice the bench actually excludes folks from getting a little bit closer here, but in this case, again, elevating the garden. Drainage became imperative. And when you consider permanent plants, woody plants, the challenge in the Midwest with this is this freezes like a icicle over the winter months, so it has to be the toughest of perennials that'll take that sort of root disturbance, that sort of brutal elevated situation. So we do a lot of seasonal plants. This is one of the beds that hosts the fragrant stocks right now. But notice the combination of a sitting area with some planted spaces. Someone going along could enjoy the plantings, wheelchair height in the distance there with some basil. So kind of a modernistic combination of planter and sitting area, but this is in a healing garden out east. So I've alluded to planters already, but again, when you consider what you're going to be growing and the users, there's a lot of things to think about. And a lot of times we jump to, what am I going to grow? That might dictate some of the dimensions in terms of soil depth, but you have to again consider those users, those volunteers, those patients, those folks that are going to be enjoying these spaces. So it's knowing your materials, that drainage. Notice I mentioned don't underestimate wet weight, the idea that can these things move? The rolling planters on the cafe at Edgerton, those can move, but if they didn't have casters or wheels on them, collectively they're about 800-900 pounds of wet soil weight. So it'd be very challenging to just lift those and move them. So overbuild and maintain for longevity. You want to make sure you've done that. But some other examples of some fun raised beds, and you're not seeing necessarily fragrant plants in this situation with kale, but you're seeing an accessible space where folks can enjoy. Ohio State University with a garden with recycled lumber raised beds. Notice the available water. So again, maintenance becomes important. I tend to think that way when I consider installing new landscapes. How do we maintain them? And that holds true with our fragrant plants, which might be the primary constituents in our landscapes. Our sensory gardens are certainly a component. But again, knowing what these plants will need from us. And that includes some watering on those hot dog days of summer. And for us, this year was extremely droughty in the Midwest. Interesting planter here with wheelchair height to the right, and a little sitting area. And then from the left, folks can approach for belly button height for a no-stoop gardening situation. So again, imagine fragrant plants put in here. There's a lot of parsley and hot peppers are what you're seeing there. And again, some examples of raised beds for a volunteer group at Rotary Gardens, where we were making sure that they were adapted to the user, specifically to the user. And Victoria, who you saw earlier in the wheelchair, we devised this planting desk for her. And so she could access these various planters, which worked out wonderfully. So again, know what you're getting into. Containers, this really goes hand in hand with what we've talked about with raised beds. And notice in this situation, no traditional plantable space. This is a driveway up against a house. So they've created gardening space, but I've said it a couple times now, knowing what sort of soil, the drainage in these pots, tomatoes, as you see here, but ultimately knowing how these will be accessed and maintained. So, as with the planters I've mentioned earlier, consider all the important things like materials, dimensions, size. What are you doing with these in the winter? If you're using annual plantings, the containers I insert annual plants into, I make sure I empty the soil out in late fall, sanitize them, and store them until the next spring. I usually don't leave soil in the smaller containers in particular. Here's a case. There's Mike Maddox on the left, a registered horticultural therapist at the Veterans Hospital in Madison. Notice the containers here. He's actually put them up on a sitting bench for this gentleman to access. So here is horticultural therapy on the fly, where these containers were moved to a location where this gentleman could access them from his chair. Here, working with peppers and some other vegetables. A repurposed AgriMaster galvanized steel bin here. We have to have drainage holes, of course. So again, you could get crafty with the containers, but they might be a great way of bringing color into a space that, again, has no traditional available gardening space, or simply elevating the garden to bring it to the users, or actually both. But they do need care. Here's some repurposed PVC pipe supporting bowls. What was fun with these planters at Rotary Gardens in our pollinator theme is it elevated these salvias where kids could see the hummingbirds zipping around. But imagine fragrant plants spilling out of this, and also, again, providing some interest. The watering certainly is a component that needs to be considered. Here's parsley in one of those. Stock tank planter with lantana. Again, stock tanks would need additional drainage holes, but I'll go through this fairly quickly. But, baskets may provide an opportunity for elevating things like strawberries. But all the nuances of care hold true with the raised beds I mentioned, the containers, and certainly baskets as a category of container. The idea with limited soil volume, watering becomes imperative. But in elevating this little mini garden, you're able to include additional interest. And here's a compact cucumber dangling out. And so there's a lot of these reduced size edibles that can be incorporated into containers, whether it's herbs or tomatoes. There's so many fun things you can put in these baskets. And at the Chicago Botanic Garden, at their Bueller Enabling Garden, it's hard to see, but there's actually a kind of a crank and cable system to raise and lower this basket. So a user could lower the basket to plant, and then, or prepare it, plant it, and then raise it into place, and then bring it up and down based on needs for watering, for a little primping, for clearing it out in fall. So a little more ornate system, but essentially a retractable up and down hanging basket. So vertical planters also offer some opportunity, also some challenges, but I've alluded to those with some limited soil volume and such. But as we finish up, I do want to point out here are some succulents. So we're not talking about fragrance here. These plants are all pretty tough and limited soil volume, but vertical gardens are not a new concept and they're not a low maintenance concept, but they may apply to our talk about fragrant plants because it's a planter that has a wide range of accessibility in terms of height for those in wheelchairs, for those standing that can't stoop or garden. It's a type of planter that may provide opportunity for garden engagement, but also that smell or sensory component. Well, there's lots of developments in these sort of cell-like situations. Here are some stacked containers. Not so much a vertical garden as a stacked container, but notice in this patio situation, there's not traditional, again, ground space. So what they've done is maximize growing space with the addition of containers that can be maintained by a gardener standing with some degree of stooping. Soil volume, again, the drainage, that all becomes important. But here's that same system with a whole bunch of different things, including vegetables, annuals, and other plantings. At the Chicago Botanic Garden, their vertical walls are just amazing. Here with their scented geraniums in here, nasturtiums. So again, anyone can engage this wall, and these aren't necessarily easy systems, and you may not have a 10-foot brick wall to play with, but vertical gardening again may offer just another component in your programs. And I love seeing this at the Chicago Botanic Garden, at the transitional vertical planter here in spring with parsley and pansies. Same planter later in summer. That's a lot of trailing oregano. That green stripe from upper left to lower right are strawberries. So this is a system that when water drains all the way down through, the soil is replaced every year. There's mesh and plastic that holds the soil in and little slits where the plants are inserted. So there's a little science to it. These plants don't mind growing this way as long as they're kept happy with the sunlight, soil, and watering. But again, anyone can go up to this and enjoy it. And there's another summer composition with trailing oregano and thyme. So an herbal engagement. And a lot of fun things. This is a more recent shot with some just a couple different things. Again, the same planter. So I, you know, kind of another fun thing to consider. And as we wrap up, we'll take some questions very shortly here, but I can't express enough the importance of not only engaging, we all work with different folks, whether it's in our home garden situations with our family, our professional affiliations with patients and caregiving situations, but gardening offers a lot for folks. But getting kids started young in the garden, I think, is vital. And you saw some early shameless images of my grandson Miles, who's amazing. He's almost two, and he's picking produce and he's smelling things and he's out in the garden very often. So the onus is on us to include these youngsters out in the garden and engage them early on. And back to the topic at hand, when we talk about fragrance, I barely scratch the surface, not only of available plant material that may offer a fragrant component in your landscape, regardless of where you live, but how to best utilize it for your user groups. And that's whether it's through the raised beds, containers, vertical gardenings, whatever, it's a matter of, again, considering the situation and offering it to the most diverse crowd you possibly can. But it's been so much fun at the Edgerton Healing Garden to have folks go through and do a little sensory scavenger hunt and enjoy the different fragrances that we've included labels for, and sort of a self-guided tour to say, there's some really neat things out here you ought to smell, not just have them sort of incidentally engage them as they go through. We're directing them to that engagement. And so there's a lot of potential for utilizing that. So thank you for your time, everyone. Again, signage, I think, has been extremely helpful. as we finish up here, if you're ever in the Wisconsin area, do visit me at the Edgerton, Wisconsin Hospital and Health Services Healing Garden. And with that, I'm going to pause the video and hopefully take a couple questions. Thank you.